You know, when it comes to psychic abilities, you may have heard people say, well, we're all a little psychic. If that is true, then being psychic would be normal instead of paranormal. But that's not what paranormal means. It means something that cannot be explained scientifically. Oh, but it can be explained scientifically. See, we look at something that is probably a part of a normal brain function, and because we don't understand the workings of it, it's paranormal. There's that lack of understanding again. This is something that can be observed. It can be measured. It can be repeated by different individuals to give similar results. It has been and is used in the gathering of intelligence by the military and local law enforcement. Come on, you think that the US military would use something that doesn't work? No, they use it because it has to work. So I'm going to discuss remote viewing. I'm going to show you how it works. And then maybe you will see that this is a formulated type of martial art, a skill set to sharpen and apply your already inherent ability to see not with your eyes, but with your mind. So I want you to think of it this way. Your mind, not your brain, but your mind, is a transmitter and receiver of frequency and vibration. Naturally, your mind does not tune into these frequencies one at a time, but it is a universal transmitter and receiver, like a radio that is tuned into every radio station all at once. So how does the mind make sense of these frequencies? Well, that is the job of the brain. Now the brain is extremely complex, so I'm going to simply break it down into two parts of consciousness, the conscious brain and the subconscious brain. The conscious brain is the surface brain. It is the brain that translates those incoming frequencies into something that you can sense. And because we have these senses, we can interact with these frequencies which make up our tangible environment. This is just the work of the sensitivities of the body. Your subconscious is what works with the sensitivities of the mind. It organizes and translates all the other frequencies that you cannot see, hear, touch, taste, or smell. So this is the best way I can explain this. If I took a piece of paper made from a particular type of wood that had a certain shape, size, and weight, that piece of paper is vibrating at a certain frequency. If I take an ink pen and write something on that piece of paper, the ink is vibrating at a certain frequency, and my thoughts that are projected onto the ink and paper vibrate at a certain frequency. So this piece of paper with writing on it, as a whole, has its own unique frequency. A frequency that you can dial into from anywhere in space and time. When you are able to dial into that frequency, your subconscious mind can translate that frequency into an image. Can translate it into a sense of touch or taste. It can even translate the information into the appropriate sound. So remote viewing is not an old concept. Years ago, the US government discovered that many of their military secrets were being obtained by the Russian government. They didn't know how this was being done until a Russian defective exposed them for using remote viewing to target the US. Target meaning the objective of the remote viewer. A person, place, or thing. So upon being notified of this, the US government put in place certain protocols to find out not only how remote viewing worked, but to find out if this is something that can be taught to anyone. And with the collaborative efforts of scientists at Stanford Research Institute, Hal Putoff and Russell Targ, and psychic artist Ingo Swann, they would begin the government-funded study of remote viewing, a project that lasted over 20 years. And they were very successful in developing a training program for their select military soldiers and intelligence agents. You may have heard of government programs such as the CIA's Project Scan-8. There is Stargate, Sunstreak. There is Project Eagle Claw and Grill Flame. All set up to test the limits of this newly discovered form of spying. First, I want to clear up some things about what people think remote viewing is. A remote viewer is not a psychic, but a psychic can be a remote viewer. But typically they play in two different ballparks. A remote viewer does not see images or videos in their head. They get flashes of information that the subconscious then translates into a sense. It's like accessing a lost memory. You just get flashes of shapes, colors, textures, smells, temperatures. It is not astral projection, as you do not leave your body. You are not asleep or unconscious. You are not channeling or having any type of out-of-body experience. Those are completely different experiences than remote viewing, and I'm going to give you one of the reasons why in a moment. So this is how it works. The viewer is given a real, non-imaginary target that they must be blind to. In other words, they cannot have any idea of what the target is. So they are usually given just a set of coordinates, or a random group of numbers or letters that represent the target. The viewer also cannot be given any clues or hints about the target. It must be non-suggestive. For example, you cannot just simply ask a remote viewer to view what's inside the Great Pyramid of Giza, because all the information the viewer already knows about the Great Pyramid will interfere with the information that is coming in. You would instead have them view the coordinates of the pyramid, provided that the viewer does not already know those coordinates, which in that case you would just provide them with an 8 to 10 digit number that is intended to represent the pyramid. The viewer then records their impressions of the target on paper. Once the viewing session has ended, the viewer must get feedback to find out how accurate they were about the target. This improves their viewing skills and increases their accuracy on the next target. Now, there are generally four types of remote viewing. The first is controlled remote viewing, or CRV. This is the most commonly used form of remote viewing that was almost exclusively used by the US military and the CIA. In CRV, there are typically six stages. First, the viewer records a gestalt. This is something that makes up the majority of the target. For example, if the target is in the desert, the viewer may get the impression of sand or the color of sand. They may get the impression of heat or dryness. Many remote viewers use an ideogram, which is nothing more than a squiggly shape or line that helps the viewer to stay focused or dialed into the target. Next, the viewer begins to collect data coming in the form of tastes, smells, textures, colors, sounds, shapes. And at this point, the data could still mean anything. However, the more the viewer works on the target, the more information comes in about the target. The viewer then records any dimensional characteristics about the target: the height, the length, the weight, whether it is large or small. Keep in mind that the viewer never tries to identify anything within their view. The viewer then records the qualitative data, describing something to be soft or hard, strong or weak, good or bad, bright or dark. Now, as the viewer collects more data, he or she must question their precepts, or in other words, they must make sure that they stick to the set rules of the session. They must make sure that the data is not contaminated with bits and pieces of their own imagination. The viewer then tries to figure out why certain pieces of data was recorded, the meaning of a word or number that was written. In the final stage of this type of remote viewing, the viewer can now begin to put together the details, an assessment, where they can draw out floor plans or create 3D models using clay or some other medium. This is where the viewer is giving great specific details of the target, the position, the location, the dimensions, descriptions of any people or animals at the target site. And this is where the picture really comes together. Now, this is a very simple progressive process that has been quite successful for the majority of viewers. Once a remote viewer has become quite good at CRV, they can use another form of remote viewing called associative remote viewing, or ARV. This involves associating a specific outcome with a specific concrete target. For example, if I wanted to know if a certain stock would go up or down at a certain time, I would give the viewer the stock and they would associate that with perhaps an arrow pointing up or an arrow pointing down. Another type of remote viewing involves using a beacon or outbounder remote viewing. This requires a person to be physically at the target. So the viewer can now use that person as a beacon to collect data about the environment around them without the person being aware of what's happening. The fourth type of RV is the most rare form, ERV, or extended remote viewing. This requires a person to monitor and guide the viewer through an extremely long session in which the viewer is in a hypnotic, trance-like state. However, these days, there are very few monitors left in the world who are trained to do this correctly. So this type of remote viewing is rarely used, if ever. There are a few issues that come up with remote viewing. The major one is mental noise. This is when your memory and imagination interferes with the data collection process. For example, if you are viewing a target that seems to be very large and mountain-like, with fire or a red-hot liquid coming out of the top of it, your memory and imagination will probably make you think that it is a volcano, when the truth is you really do not know what it is. And truly good remote viewers will not guess or make assumptions. Now, some remote viewers go through what's called a cool-down phase, where they get themselves into a meditative state to help them clear their minds. But it has been found that it is not necessary, and it causes the viewer to have to ritualistically go into this cool-down phase every time they begin a session, which in time constraints can become a handicap, such as closing your eyes. Some viewers close their eyes, but again, you have to record things down on paper, which requires you to open your eyes. So many remote viewers are not taught to close their eyes during a session. Sometimes there is an overlay of information coming from the environment around the viewer. It could be the distracting sound of a clock ticking, the movement of a person walking around you. Sometimes other remote viewers can interfere with what's coming in if they are viewing the same target. Which brings up another issue, psychics. Now, a psychic can be a remote viewer and they can be quite good at it. However, a remote viewer pulls in information from the target to them, whereas a psychic tends to psychically travel to the target, and this can cause detection. You see, remote viewers are not detected, but because a psychic is visiting a target site, and sometimes hanging around the site, animals can detect them, and people can detect them. But, apparently, there are claims that there exists a species of alien beings that can see remote viewers. This is one of the reasons that remote viewing is not a toy and should be done responsibly. I do not recommend trying to remote view anything that has to do with aliens, or any non-human entity for that matter. Also, be aware, just like hypnosis can heal, it can hurt. And there exists a small possibility that a viewer can experience the injury or pain of someone or something at the target site that they are viewing. As in anything that requires a skill set, folks, there are people who are bad at it, and there are people who are incredibly great at it. Imagine being able to remote view the contents of a sealed envelope or security safe. Imagine being able to see what's behind doors 1, 2, and 3. Imagine being able to locate stolen property or a missing person. Imagine being able to see what's on Mars or what's hidden deep in the oceans of the Earth. Imagine being able to go backward or forwards in time and space to collect data on past and future events. Hopefully, at this point, you are able to see the benefits to having such a skill. Another superhuman ability buried deep within all of us. The success rate of professional remote viewing is over 80%, folks, so there is something to this. So maybe now with this extra bit of knowledge, you can look at certain topics and look at remote viewers with a bit more faith in their findings, as conventional methods of investigation sometimes leave us hanging with many questions. I wanted to provide you with a better understanding of remote viewing, because you're going to need to know a little something about it when I use that term again in future videos. You know, isn't it interesting that the things we consider to be paranormal are beginning to become a bit more normal every day?